One, two, three, four, one. Praise you in the heavens, join with the angels, praise you forever and a day. Praise you on earth now, join with creation, calling all nations to your praise. We could see how much you're worth, how you're my, you're endless love. Surely we will never cease to pray.
Let us gather together this morning for worship. I'm going to begin with a call to worship, and your response is when it says, all. God said, let light shine into the darkness. Lord, shine your light into our lives. We see the glory of God in the face of Jesus. The light of Jesus is with us day by day. Let us follow the light of Jesus together. Let us worship God with thanks and praise. Let us gather in prayer. Let us pray. God of grace and glory, to this worried world you revealed your presence in radiant glory and in gentle whispers. On mountaintops and in shadowed valleys, in classrooms and hospital beds, in homes and churches, in the quiet of nature and on busy streets. Yours is the presence that pushes past our fear to calm us. Yours is the love that transforms our doubts with reassurance. We come to dwell in your goodness and offer you the praise you deserve. God of mercy and forgiveness, we confess that there are many things that keep us from trusting fully in your love. We often get distracted by our own desires and disappointments. We sometimes cling to anger and resentment, and we fear the future rather than seek signs of hope. Lord, forgive us. Shine your light down upon us so that your glory may be seen in us. And give us courage to follow Jesus wherever he leads, for we pray in his name. Amen.
God is love. Compare and adore it. God is love.
Happy Valentine's Day from white and wintry Owen Sound. I hope you are someplace comfortable and warm, perhaps with tea or coffee in hand, or a heart-shaped cookie. I'm Steve Warner, and along with Matthew Allard, we help to create and coordinate the content for our weekly live streams from St. Andrew's Church, along with a great team of people that partner together to bring you these virtual services. Thanks to the choir for that hymn we just heard, and thanks to Brian for adding some guitar on that first song I opened with. As you've witnessed already, Reverend Ted Crean is with us today, as Jerry is off this week. We'll be hearing from Ted in a little bit as he shares a message for this morning. Every week we're fortunate to have a visit from our furry little raccoon friend, Andy. Well, today, and appropriately on Valentine's Day, Andy has a new friend visiting him, Sid the Turtle. And for those that remember the cute Andy to St. Andrew's connection, you'll no doubt pick up on another location connection with this little turtle's name. After that, Pat will share with us our scripture for today. I'll be back after that.
Comes our friend Sid, our Sydenham River Turtle, is something for you. It's a Valentine. How nice. Friends and family can tell each other on Valentine's Day how much they love each other. We could send a homemade Valentine by mail or email or text, saying that we love them. We can share our love every day to show that we care. In 1 Corinthians, we find a passage about love and how love is just the best thing ever. Say goodbye.
Corinthians chapter 13, the gift of love. If I speak in the tongues of mortals and of angels, but do not have love, I am a noisy gong or a clanging cymbal. And if I have prophetic powers and understand all mysteries and all knowledge, and if I have all faith so as to remove mountains, but do not have love, I am nothing. If I give away all my possessions, and if I hand over my body so that I may boast, but do not have love, I gain nothing. Love is patient. Love is kind. Love is not envious or boastful or arrogant or rude. It does not insist on its own way. It is not irritable or resentful. It does not rejoice in wrongdoing, but rejoices in the truth. It bears all things, believes all things, hopes all things, endures all things. Love never ends. But as for prophecies, they will come to an end. As for tongues, they will cease. As for knowledge, it will come to an end. For we know only in part, and we prophesy only in part. But when the complete comes, the partial will come to an end. When I was a child, I spoke like a child. I thought like a child. I reasoned like a child. When I became an adult, I put an end to childish ways. For now we see in a mirror dimly, but then we will see face to face. Now I know only in part, then I will know fully, even as I have been fully known. And now faith, hope, and love abide, these three, and the greatest of these is love. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God.
Thanks, Sharon, Pat, Lori, and Brian, for everything we just enjoyed there. This is Valentine's Day, of course, and although the focus of it tends to be on romantic or friendship love, it's also a good time for us to consider the love we show to our neighbors, the world around us, whether next door, across our city and region, or on the other side of the globe. How is our love thy neighbor going? This next song reminds us of that and calls us to a love that is walked out in compassion, justice, respect, inclusion, a love that lifts, that reaches to the margins, that gives dignity and embraces as family. Please sing along with the praise team and myself.
The poor are rich, the weak are strong, the foolish ones.
Well, it's good to be with you this morning, folks. Just before I give the message, I just want to pause for a moment to remember a very long and faithful friend of St. Andrew's, Fay Lemon. Now, Fay passed away this past week. Fay was a valiant member of session. She was clerk of session for a while. But there, I guess as from a staff perspective, from a minister's perspective, Fay's great heart for this church and for the people, she once a year held a special dinner for all the staff and their spouses and families, which really did amount to quite a few folks. But in the later years, Fay had moved to Burlington to be closer to her son and grandson, and unfortunately passed away this past week. We will certainly remember with fondness the life of Fay Lemon. Now, this is Valentine's Day. Well, I thought, well, since Valentine's Day this year falls on a Sunday, I, of course, must preach on love. So I'm going to be referring to the most excellent way, which is in 1 Corinthians chapter 13. But let me use a little show and tell. How's that to begin with? So I brought an orchid, and this is a gift to my wife. Many years I get an orchid just for Easter, or for Valentine's Day. And here is this one for this year. It's a kind of intriguing looking thing with many blossoms and I hope a few buds that will nourish us for a while. Now, I bring this orchid because it is a thing of fascination and beauty. God's creation is like that. And orchids are very unique. I mean, it gets a lot of moisture from the air, from these air roots. The blossoms are intricate and very beautiful. So I think an orchid is a gift. It's a gift from God unto us and to the world. It's a gift that I want to share with my wife. But as in all good object lessons, there is a lesson here too. Now, this orchid will look beautiful. We'll just put it in a safe spot and enjoy it for weeks to come. Orchids will bloom for a long time. But they will eventually stop blooming. And if I'm careful, I can take care of it and watch it carefully, feed it when it's necessary, and maybe in another year it'll bloom all over again. So the object lesson, the story for us, of course, is like life's relationships. There's beauty, there's attraction, there's all those things, but to make them continue to live to their utmost beauty requires a bit of care and work. So I am going to be responsible for this flower to make sure it blooms as long as I can and to keep it alive and blooming for as long as I can, and that could be many years. Now let's think about relationships. Well, a relationship, especially on a Valentine's Day of hearts and flowers and chocolates and all those good things. Yes, emotions, feelings, attractions, shared experiences, all those things that draw us together in marriages and in families and friendships, in church and in community. And we think also of God's very special gift, and that's where I want to really begin with today. Because when we think of the gift of God's love, and especially in this passage that Pat read for us this morning from 1 Corinthians 13, which Paul calls the more excellent way, he uses love a lot. But in the New Testament, it is a very special love, and it's called agape or agape. Now, that's God's special gift of love. offered to us in Jesus Christ, his forgiving love, his desire to bring us into true relationship with him, to fill us every day with that love and everything that goes with it. It's a forgiving, healing, strengthening love. And it can form the root of every relationship we have if we so choose to make it work, just like the care that's necessary for that orchid. Now, Paul celebrates that in 1 Corinthians chapter 13. It's really like a prism. And one writer likened that to God's love shining through a prism. Now, a prism will break the light into all the components, like a rainbow. And then we see the aspects of God's love laid out one by one. Now, it is a very beautiful, wholesome, it's the highest we know in love, why Paul calls it the more excellent way. And it's best illustrated in the life of Jesus. Now, I want to do a couple of little exercises this morning. To begin with, let us look at Paul's letter of love, his poem to love, 1 Corinthians 13. But let us look at it in terms of Jesus, because Jesus is the model for this love. When we see God's agape love in Jesus, we can see how it works here on earth in living relationships. So if you remember a few minutes ago when Pat read that lesson, we say love is patient, love is kind, love is not envious or boastful or arrogant, love does not insist on its own way, love is not irritable or resentful, and the list goes on. Now let's think about that, and I'm going to read a portion of that passage, but I'm going to, instead of love, insert the word Jesus. So Jesus is patient. Jesus is kind. Jesus is not envious or boastful or arrogant. Jesus does not insist on his own way. Jesus is not irritable or resentful. Jesus does not keep a record of wrong. Jesus is not happy with evil or wrongdoing. Jesus is happy with truth. And so Jesus bears all things. Jesus hopes all things. Jesus endures all things. Now, I hope you get a bit of a grasp of the enormous strength and all the dimensions of agape God love. And that is the love Paul is really drawing us towards and offering not only to the Corinthian church, but to all of us. Now, we know that passage well. It's often read at weddings, but Paul did not write it as a poem for weddings. Paul inserted it not at the very beginning of the book of 1 Corinthians or his letter to them, but well along in chapter 13. Why did he do that? Well, Paul had established the church in Corinth. Now, Corinth was a busy, cosmopolitan Greek city. And so in those days, there would have been people of all kinds, all shapes, sizes, certainly all kinds of religions and a lot of idol worship and everything else that went along with that. Paul arrived, started preaching about a very different kind of love, about one true God who came in Jesus Christ, and through Jesus' death and resurrection offered us total forgiveness and the establishment of true relationship that is a living relationship with God. Now, that was pretty exciting, because in the letter that Paul writes, he refers to some of the worship, for instance, in the Corinthian church, and it was very exciting, full of the Holy Spirit, very dynamic, people praying and prophesying, even speaking in tongues. Paul talks about gifts that the Spirit brings to make possible a beautiful and wonderful church. Paul talks about diversity, Because in the Corinthian church, this love of God and Jesus drew together people that otherwise wouldn't really associate with one another, Jews and Greeks, for instance, male and female. They often were subdivided and kept separate in worship. And even slaves and free, or perhaps more significantly slaves and free, worshiping as equal brothers and sisters in Jesus Christ. So enormous, bringing together some of the divisions that existed in the culture of Corinth, bringing them together in one place. Wow, it was full of this love. Well, to a degree, it was also full of problems. And so Paul takes one by one through chapters, the early chapters in the book of 1 Corinthians, a lot of problems. One of them was, well, there were rich people and poor people. There were slaves and free. And when they worshiped, they often began with a kind of potluck supper called an agape feast. Now, the rich people got there early, and without thinking, they just ate all the food. And the poorer people that had to work longer, when they got there, there wasn't much left. And so then when they came to celebrate communion at the end of that meal, they weren't really in sync. And Paul didn't like that, because that was not the model he wanted. So what I'm getting at here is that Paul is offering us a high love, a love that gives. Now, let's think, remember, all those qualities, that prism I said, love is patient, love is kind, love is not envious or boastful or arrogant, does not insist on its own way, all modeled after the Jesus who came to earth to teach us the way in which to follow. And so, as we celebrate love, here in a Christian church and in Christian fellowship, we celebrate an enormous love and a powerful love and a love that reaches down to grab us and invite us to live that way. So agape love is more than feelings, more than emotions. It certainly has all that, but it is an act of will. Remember my little illustration with my orchid plant that would take some care to keep it living, keep it blooming, keep it beautiful. Well, agape love is a gift. It is the free gift of forgiveness. We can't earn it. We just accept it. But then, to make it work in our relationships, in our lives, we have to roll up our sleeves. And sometimes, when we don't all feel tremendously emotionally loving, that's when we need to take it and make it to work. That's when patience and kindness and hope and faith all are so necessary. So what I would like to do at this point is the second part of my little exercise. So going back to the letter, agape or Christ-like love, Jesus love, is patient and kind. All right? We heard it read by Pat. I went over it as an illustration of who Jesus is. Now, remember, I'm offering it to you in terms of how you will make it work in your life and in your relationships. I'm going to go through that list again, but instead of love or instead of Jesus, I'm going to leave a little pause. Well, perhaps I will say my voice, because what I want is you to put in your name. I put in my name. So remember, we said love is patient, or Jesus is patient. This time, I want to hear myself or yourself say your name. You are patient, or you are called to be. Now, as I'm doing that, take time to reflect for a minute or go back over it afterwards. There's a reason for that. All right, here's our exercise. Ted is patient. Ted is kind. Ted is not envious or boastful or arrogant. Ted does not insist on his own way. Ted is not irritable or resentful. Ted does not keep a record of wrongs. Ted is not happy with evil or wrongdoing. Ted is happy with truth. Ted bears all things. Ted hopes all things. Ted endures all things. Now, that is putting yourself in Jesus' place, or allowing Jesus to put himself into your place. And that, with that, brings that enormous agape love. Now, if you're like me, now certainly when I did this the first time going over it, I thought, well, now, Lord Jesus, you may be patient and kind and all those wonderful things. There are times I have to admit I'm not all that patient. And perhaps, yeah, I can remember or recall things I've said that may not have been kind. There are times maybe I've insisted on my own way rather than listen than care for. So it goes on. And that's one of the reasons I did that exercise. We're not perfect. Jesus is our model, yes. Paul puts that love chapter to invite us to a higher calling in love. However, well, we strive for it. We work towards it. It's the care, like caring for an organ. It's the care for our relationships in our lives, every kind of relationship that we're in. And so that's an invitation to say, well, there may be a couple of things there we need to take a little time and work on. Good. That's why I'm offering it today like this. So when you feel a bit challenged, go back over that love passage. Read it again. Put your name into it. Allow God to call out where you might need to do a little more work for yourself in order that he may shine his love so fully through you that your relationships will be transformed. That's what Paul wanted for his church in Corinth. So he dealt strictly and right off the bat with problems, but then offered this amazing love that no other place you can find. May you discover the agape, freeing, giving, selfless love of Jesus. May that be your inspiration and the nourishment of your life and all of your relationships. Let us pray. Lord God, on this Valentine's Day, when we think about love, instruct us and challenge us, but also fill us with your love. Lord, we crave, especially in this COVID time when sometimes we're not physically present, but enable us, Lord, to live out that love. Give us endurance and patience when we need it. Give us kind words to say, encouragement and loving actions in any way we can. Fill us to overflowing with your special agape love in Jesus' name. Amen.
Love divine, all loves excelling, joy of heaven, to earth come down. Fix in us thy humble dwelling, mercy's crown, Jesus.
Thank you, Ted, for that great reminder, and the choir for underscoring that thought. I hope you've enjoyed our time together today, and thanks to everyone that contributed to our live stream. A big thanks to Doug for not only editing the songs I record and adding nature imagery to them, but also now for helping us pull some praise team vocals into the songs I lead. Remember to visit our YouTube channel for music, children's content, and more from past streams. There's quite a lot of stuff there now. Ted is going to bring a benediction for us to close, and then we'll wrap up our time with the song You Say, which, using some of the same technology Doug has utilized to include praise team vocals, has allowed us to bring my daughter Paige into carrying some of this song for us. Have a great week, everyone, and we'll see you next week.
And now, filled with God's abundant love, grace, and peace, and all the lovely and wonderful gifts that He has for you, go this week to fulfill your ministry, to serve Jesus however and wherever He leads. And may the love of our God, our loving Father God, the grace of our Lord Jesus, the Christ, the Messiah, and the fulfillment and the power of His Holy Spirit be yours now and always. Amen.
I keep fighting voices in my mind that say I'm not. Every single lie that tells me I will never measure up. Am I more than just the sum of every high and every low? Remind me once again just who I am, because I need to know. you say of me, I believe. The only thing that matters now is everything you think of me.
What you say?